to call her. This is Africa Shay. This is Baby Girl. This is his firstborn, and I think he's so cool because his birthday is 12-12-12. Yeah. And he also has another daughter named Giselle, but she lives out of state. But these little people are every bit of him, too. It's so interesting. They have wrote some nice poems and stuff. Y'all want to read my poems? This girl right here got a whole song with her daddy. It's so cool. And with Father's Day coming up, I need y'all to learn this song because y'all got fathers and they song is so cool. It's gonna be stuck in your head.
I didn't get to make money.
And then where's his sisters? Kennedy and Madison, I'm looking for you. Hey! Give it up for the sisters, y'all. Take a look at my amazing best friend. Raise your hand if you are a female and you love this man. Don't laugh, because I know I was his best friend. I don't care if you got a new boyfriend, I don't care if you got an old boyfriend, but if you love, because love, we all supposed to love, right? So. But now, I want to cut out the men because he got some brothers. Been and done that with him. You one of his brothers, can you raise your hand? I wanna know who everybody is. Hey, brothers.
They're still on the road.
And yeah, it is some still on the road. We come from near and far, cause this man, he went everywhere. I'm so glad he got to live the life he lived and experienced. You got some stories? Yes, they all got stories. And I want some of you guys to share some of your stories because that's what's been helping me hearing y'all's stories and hearing y'all talk the way that he talked. I didn't even realize I talked about him, but like me and Kayla were making all of these delicious edibles because he has a recipe and it has to be how he wanted. Even the shape, like with the cookies, I'm sitting there making them and I told y'all like I still talk to him. So like, how would you make a cookie swell? Cookies are circles, so now I gotta figure out how to get your cookies swell in this packager because when he would want me to do stuff and I would do it my own way because you asked me to do it, so let me do it. We used to have to argue about stuff like that. I just thought that I had to share. But anyway, hey! This is Layla, one of his other babies. First of all the kids was his kids and he told them all something, I'm telling you. Kennedy has a dance that he liked, and I wanted to do it for you guys. It's an amazing dance. Yes, can you play something else? Come on, soon. You want some about it, so I'm sharing it with y'all. And then this is his last one, like Cosmic Earth from Venice, like the gross. Like this stuff, this hoodie I could wear every day. It's so soft. And we're gonna have more of this merch because I used to go with him to the stores and like do all this. So please support when the website go up, when you see a post, like please share it because I will still continue to run all of this because I feel like he took me along the way and he took a lot of other people along the way with what he had planned because he really wanted all of us to be our own village, our own government.
Hemp was the first one that I helped him to found. Of course, I had to be the money behind it. And it was just, I just want you to know what it stands for. You know, help everybody make peace. And it says so right here, help everybody make peace, embroidered here. One of the things that I really love is he was very strategic about this globe here that's embroidered. It has Africa right here. It shows Africa, but then it's also inside of a peace sign. So he was very, very strategic when he did this. And his five, that may have a couple of meanings. Some of y'all know some things. And his birthday was five. And then there's the five principles of something or other that I never could remember. And if I'm correct, it was Madison who helped him come up with this cosmic Earth logo. And again, we have the globe showing Africa. And again, y'all know his first daughter's name is Africa. And then the eye dotted with the weed leaf because that's what he did. And everybody doesn't know, but I sent my son knew how to grow weed on his own before I knew he knew how to grow weed. And I found a plant in my house, and that didn't go so well. But you know, we made up, and I realized that ultimately weed was going to become legal in our state. So I wanted to put him in front of it, so I sent him to school to get certified. So I sent him to Oaksterdam University. He did the training in Las Vegas, and he got trained in the horticulture, the organic grow, the lighting, the pH balancing, the pesticides. So some, just, you know, I'm moved away, but some of the things that I had to live with my son, because he was so natural and so organic. In order to keep aphids off of his plants, he bought ladybugs. So that means not only do I have your plant in my house, but now I gotta have ladybugs in my house too. So, and he would just put them on the plants and they would, you know, eat the aphids. And every now and again, there's a ladybug flying around my house. So he really made me do a lot of things that I did not wanna do, but he was so, I don't wanna say adventurous, but I think he was pretty ingenious. He was very intelligent. And, you know, I supported him no matter what, because he had dreams and I believed in him and I believed in his dreams. One of the things that he always reminds me of is that I told him, Robert, find your passion. His passion was weed.
Yeah.
So that's what it was, and that's what he did. And it took me a little while to get used to it. But ultimately, once I realized what he had been trying to tell me all along, I realized I had made some mistakes in my thinking to Shaharia.
Because he paved his own way. He did this to me, so I'm giving it to y'all. But I do want y'all to be encouraged to not just believe everything that the government teach, tell, and pretty much taught you. So if you need to read a book, it's called Unfuck Yourself, and you will be mind-boggled by how much your belief is obscured by the enemy. I don't know. I just say it like that. But just be more mindful. Allow your intuition to guide you, because we are a room full of the people that he wanted to have the hugest impact on, his people that were in his community. You here, you in his community, so he cared about you. Otherwise, you wouldn't be him. So, Kennedy.
Hey.
So Robert comes in and he's like,
me, download Karma.
I'm like, what? What is Karma?
He's like, this is app. You know, you can pay for things over time. You can pay for them in like segments or whatever. Okay. Downloaded Karma. He wanted me to get this headset thing for the helmet so that he could listen to music and talk to people on the motorcycle while he was riding, so he didn't have to pick up his phone and answer his phone and everything while he was on the bike. Then somehow we segue to Aura, his dog.
And me and Kennedy had come up with this consensus that Aura was not the same dog that he had in Atlanta, bro.
He was not the same dog. That's not his dog.
Let me tell you what happened. So he had to come back to Illinois, and he had to leave Aura there, or the dog there. And somebody had called and said, hey, I found your dog, like all the way in Atlanta. So he went to go pick the dog up, and he came back with a completely different dog. And me and Kennedy are like, this dog is smaller, she's lighter, she's like
a girl at that. So the dog was not a girl. It was definitely a male dog.
To you.
Yeah.
That was
It's Aura. And he stood there just like that and was like, that's my dog. But it wasn't. And we were just sharing laughter about that. Then afterwards, he rolled this J, and I sat there looking at him. I was like, boy, that oversized rock! And then, they were laughing about that for a while.
Little labor of love, thank you. That Keisha and Kennedy sent some pictures, and I just kind of just put some things together. Maybe I thought that what they would want to say. Okay, here we go. Yes, and I asked Keisha when we were, I just said, what's his name? She said Robert Demetrius Jackson, the whole Robert Demetrius Jackson. Now that's the name for you, right? So here we go.
I must share with you some funny stories of the love of my life, Mr. Robert Demetrius Jackson. At 2 years old and 9 months, on February 21st, 1996, at 9:30 p.m., Bobby had a guest over named Saharia, who was presently 3 and will be 4 in September. The two of them were playing quietly in the room at 10951 South Longwood when I walked in to check on them, and I found them in the closet, but naked. Bobby was standing up and Saharia was sitting on the floor trying to put her clothes back on. She was going so fast that she was putting her pants on without her panties. I was stunned, astonished to say the least. I closed the door back to gain my composure. Then I opened it back up and dressed Bobby and told Saharia to go home. I didn't tell her dad because he answered the door. August 11th, 1998. Mommy and little Bobby worked really hard and accomplished bike riding without any training wheels. This is our milestone. This was the second real day of practice, spread out over a week. Happy, happy, joy, joy. April 5th, 1998. At 4 years old, Bobby knows how to read. The most readable book, Go Dog Go. He acquired his library card in February 1998, contingent upon his ability to write his own name on the line on the application. We've gone to the library every Saturday since he received his card. He gets books and videos, and we read 1 to 2 books per night. He also loves being read to. He played soccer for 4 weeks at the Morgan Park Academy gym. It's really fun to watch because he really enjoyed himself. He'll be playing at ASO Soccer this summer, beginning in June, still doing gymnastics. Almost has his flip-flop down. He's really, really strong. I love you, son.
Wanna say bye-bye?
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Say bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
This your boombox?
Coming out.
You cut it off? You cut it on? Christmas 1994, December 25th, and that's little Bobby playing with his new toys on Christmas 94. Look at him. You should have seen him when he first woke up and came down here and seen all these toys. He went into a frenzy. He ran to the basketball hoop, which is over here. Let's see. There it is. And he ran, and immediately he picked up the ball and threw it to the hoop. And where's the ball? There's the ball. And there's this little fire engine. And there he is playing with his little people garage. And let's see. There's some other things for him under the tree. He's got, God bless you.
Boy.
Boy. Look at your boy. Hmm. Pooh, look, you got an airplane up there. Look, Bobby. See, look, right there. Turn around, look. Bobby. Bobby, look at mommy. See, got an airplane right there? Look. He's not looking. Look over there. Bobby. Over there. Turn around, stand up. Come here. You see it? There it is. Get the airplane that you saw at the store. Well, you don't see it, huh?
Airplane.
Yeah. There it is. You know how to do it. You saw it at the store. Bring it to mommy. You bring your airplane to mommy? Hmm? Yeah. Let me see it. Yes, your toy went off. Pooh, why don't you throw your ball in the hoop for mommy? Throw it. Hey! You gonna do it one more time? Can you do it again? Let mommy see you throw the ball in the hoop one more time. Let's go. Yay! He's trying. He's getting close. One more time. You gonna throw it one more time? Yay! You got it in there! You saw it for the first time on tape. Go, Bobby! Yeah! Number one NBA pick! Oh, yay. Hey, look at that baby play ball. Jason is ball now. Yeah, you can play ball. What's your name? What's your name?
Rabbit.
Yay!
Look at my name.
Hey, Boo.
Why are you never moving the camera? Did you ask you to record him?
Bobby, say happy birthday to you.
Bobby's love for dogs probably started around the age of 2. When I was 2, I was very afraid of dogs. There were so many dogs in my neighborhood. Every time my mom and I went for a walk and I saw a dog, I would almost jump in my mommy's skin. Finally, my mom decided I should have a dog. That's how I got my Peaches. And I guess that's how he started his love for dogs.
Know, loving you is like food to me. Yes, it is. Oh, yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Oh, you're always down for me, have always been around for me, even when I was bad. You've shown me right from my wrongs. Yes, you did. And you took up for me when everyone was down on me. You always did understand. You gave me strength to go on.
There were so many times looking back when I was so afraid. And then you come to me and say to me, I could face anything. And no one else can do what you've done for me. You'll always be.
Block declaration, 59th and 5th Ave, granny house with vanilla wafers. It's the remedy to separation, Tupac of my generation. Blue pill in the fucking matrix, red rose in the gray pavement. Young black nigga trapped and he can't change it. Know he a genius, he just can't claim it, cause they left him no platforms to explain it. He frustrated so he get faded, but deep down inside he know you can't fade him. How long should I stay dedicated? How long till opportunity meet preparation? I need some real nigga reparations, or I run up in your bank just for recreation.
And
dedication,
eight.
Hard work, plus patience. Some more my sacrifice, I'm done waiting. I'm done waiting, told you that I wasn't playing. Now you hear what I've been saying.
Oh.
Dedication. Dedication.
Spent my whole life thinking out the box. Boxing homies, 3-on-1, got DP, but I ain't dropped. Chirp on me, here I come. Spin around the block, they broke on me. Said I ran a stop sign, but that's a lie. I spent my whole life staring at the stage, playing Sega, daddy smoking Sherm, mama playing spades, catching vapors. Grandma said I get some Jordans for my grades. That's my baby. When she died, my heart broke 100 ways. I spent my whole life trying to make it, trying to chase it. The cycle of a black man divided, trying to break it. You take a lost shit, don't cry about it, just embrace it. Minor setback for major comeback, that's my favorite. My nigga L said you do a song with Nip. K-Dot, he a better grip. I said he a man first, you hear the words out his lips. About flourishing from the streets to black businesses. Level 4, y'all living, giving to false imprisonment. Listen close, my nigga, it's bigger than deuces and foes, my nigga. Since elementary, we close, my nigga, you're straight like that. I give you the game, go back to the turf and give it right back. For generations, we've been dealt bad hands with bad plans. Prove your dedication by hopping out Grand Ams. I'm at the premiere, politicking with Top Nip and Snoop. Damn, clock watching the way we groove. Dedication.
If it ain't congratulating, it look like hate. If it ain't congratulating, it look like what Nip said.
Hold up.
La, this ain't entertainment. It's folk niggas on a slave ship. These songs just the spirituals I swam against them waves with. Ended up on shore today, amazement. I hope the example I set's not contagious. Lock us behind gates, but can't tame us. Used to be stay safe, now stay dangerous. Cause ain't no point playing defense, nigga. That's why I dove off the deep end, nigga, without a life jacket. Couple mil, tour the world, all my life cracking. Cook the books, bring it back, so it's no taxes. Royalties, publishing, plus our own masters. I'd be damned if I slave for some white crackers. I was mapping this out, I hit the heights backwards. Topping out the 85 and Reebok classics. Read a couple marathons just to get established. To make it happen, you got to have dedication. Hard work, plus patience. To some more of my sacrifice, I'm done waiting. I'm done waiting, told you that I wasn't playing. Now you hear what I've been saying. Dedication.
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 You got it now. Let's go. Says she got something to say.
Rock out with my dad.
said she rock out with her dad.
Rock out with my dad.
She said she rock out with her dad.
Rock out with my dad.
She said she rock out with her dad.
Rock out with my dad.
She said she, look. I ain't really want my baby girl to grow up, but it is what it is. Shit. Reality is where I live. Had to hop in teacher mode. And I never knew how to swing on a pole. Do know how to be a hoe, so I gotta let her know how niggas coming out the door.
You silly, Aiden. Why are you screaming?
Snake once. I remember him feeding the snake a live mouse, and I was just watching it for like as long until it was finished eating. And I remember we were chilling on the living room floor in the old house, and I was playing with either I think it was Scooter or the other bearded dragon whose name I forgot. And he was like, okay, so I was like, I think I said something along the lines of, why'd you name him Bizarre? I was like, what's that? It sounds like a flower. And he was like, it's a strain of weed. And I was like, oh. Alright, yeah, it's cool. And another memory I have is just recently he was like trying to convince me every day after I got home from school, he would be like, Madison, hop on the bike, come on, hop on the bike with me. It'll be so much fun, I promise. And I was like, I am scared of that bike. And one day I finally was like, fine, I got on the bike with you, and we rode down to Waltz, and it was actually one of my greatest memories of him. We just like rode around the parking lot for a little bit. I have no idea why we did that, rode around the parking lot, but yeah. And so then we took back to the house, and I was like, okay, that was actually kind of fun. And so when I got off, I realized that I was actually not sitting on it right, and I was crushing his balls against the front. The whole time, I was like, I hope I was sitting on the right. He was like, yeah, more. So yeah, that's my brother. He's hilarious. He's great. He's amazing.
All right, so I'm gonna share what I wrote for my son to take with him when we finalize his remains. And it's so much to say, so I can only say so much, but my son, there are few words that can ever fully express what you meant to me. For whatever reason the universe intended, I've been fighting for you since you were in the womb, literally. The first fight was your dad, who wanted me to terminate you. The next was kindergarten, when the principal of Clisso wanted you out of the school. Next was every school you ever attended that made you out to be some terrible child when you were being nothing more than a child. I fought repressive, outdated rules. I fought stupid state laws. I fought companies that practice legal hiring discrimination by not hiring people based on background checks. I fought the fake ban the box law that simply removed the are you a felon question from the front of the job application to the back end during the application or background check and still ensured you wouldn't be hired. I fought school principals who wanted to suspend you from school for something that happened on the bus instead of just suspending you from the bus. I fought the guy who shot out the car window at you. Yes, and Robert doesn't know this, I found where he lived. And I went right to his house, and I told his father, and we had a conversation. He arranged for me to meet with the son who shot at my son. And when I first met him, he looked like a regular dad. But then I went back and he looked like somebody out of Compton.
Okay.
He had a bandana on his head. And I was like, what did I just get myself into? But I went up in that house and I had a conversation with him and his son. And I had to explain to his son, you all fighting my son, you all shot at my son over a high school fight that he had with somebody over his girlfriend. Did you know that? He had no clue. I said, so yeah, you trying to kill my son over some beef that was squashed long time ago. The boy who he fought is not even here. And you're carrying this on. You done shot after my son. You shot out my car window. You could have killed him. I said, and let me just say this to you. You think you're going to hurt my son if you kill him. No, sweetie, you're going to hurt me and his sisters and his grandmother. So his father assured me that I would never have to have any more problems out of that young man again. And that was the end of that. I fought my son's felony to be removed, and I succeeded. I fought baby mamas, and they all can attest to it, left and right, for your right to be in your children's lives. Why do you have so many baby mamas? I know why he had so many baby mamas. He was trying to fill a void that was left by his father. He wanted to be the man who he thought should have been the man for him. I fought people who thought I should throw you out on the streets. I fought the car dealership that sold you a lemon, and I won you your money back, $27,000 to be exact. I fought for you to make your tips at the Garth Brooks concert. I fought for you to live. I won so many of these fights, including the fight for you to live, because even though you died, you lived. You lived large, bold, and undaunted. You traveled this nation on a shoestring budget, like weekly. Arizona, Atlanta, Florida, taking the kids to Universal Studios, just up and driving the kids somewhere, or hopping on a plane with money that I don't even know where it came from, but he made it happen. Cosmic Earth Organics, whatever he was doing. And while he was doing all this, I was left at home babysitting dogs and plants. He got some certifications in between. And when this country said you cannot work due to your background, you found your middle finger, you put it up in the air, and you created your own business two times. Hemp Brand Clothing and Cosmic Earth Organics. Yeah. There's too much to say, and I can't say it all today. So I'll end it this way. I love you, son.
Yeah. His experiences with him, just watching him and my daughter play. And me and my neighbor, and loving them, you know, like they my family. So I'm heartbroken, but we don't know what the Almighty has planned. So I figure he's our angel now, and he's going to open up ways and help guide us through. So I just thank God for letting me even have them in my life for the time that I give. So I'm blessed for that. Thank you.
I'm Alice Jackson, better known as G-Ma, G-G, Homie G. I also have several names for them. The Lobster, Roberto. This is very, very hard for me, and I have a whole lot I would love to say, but I'm just so stunned and trying to hold back my pain. And I've been trying to take to turn pain into purpose. And I'm glad to know there's so many different people in his life. I love him. He was a grandmother's boy, more than a mama's boy. It was like good cop, bad cop. I was the bad cop because I stayed in that hut. He would try me a lot of times. There was times I would tell him, don't go down there and play basketball at that court. Don't keep your pants up. He didn't want to keep his pants up, so I pulled mine down. Then he got upset. He goes, put it on my pants. I said, what you doing? You gonna be embarrassed. I said, Mom, you gonna be embarrassed. And you can hang yours down, I'm gonna walk around with my ass down. So he decided to get it together. But other than that, we toughed it out. And he always respected and loved me for getting it up. Didn't want to have to do it, but he was always challenging me. So, G-Mom, Gigi did what she had to do. And I just loved him with all my heart. Thank you.
Me and Robert had a very love-hate relationship. He was the only parent I knew that taught his one-year-old how to say fuck the police. I'm like, why are you teaching him this? It was a lot of stuff that Ed came home and said. And he's like, my daddy told me, my daddy said, my daddy. I'm like, oh my gosh, what is this? So we definitely had a lot of different ways of what we thought was right as far as parenting. And that's where we clashed a lot. But through it all, I always still had love for him and respected him as Aiden's father. All
right.
One thing I never did was ever talk bad about Robert in front of Aiden. And I expected the same. Mm-hmm. Aiden adored his father. Mm-hmm. And he was always with his father every chance Robert could get him. Because as everybody else said, Samara, she know, we done been through a lot of stuff together too. back when we was younger. And Lakeisha, everybody know, he did whatever he could do for his kids. Mm-hmm. If that meant going to jail, if that meant fighting, if that meant shooting, whatever it consisted of, Robert was going to do it if it meant to see his kids.
That's right.
He would argue me up and down and didn't care how I felt about it. And at the end of the argument, he was like, so where I'm picking him up at? What time we meeting up? What you going to do? I'm like, did you not just say anything I just said? Like, no. You know. But I never tried to keep Aiden away from his dad. And even though we did have different styles of parenting, Aiden has learned a lot from his father. I remember it was a lot for me to try to pipe train him. And Robert, like, got it down packed with him in like 2 days. And I was like, okay. Then I remember I was trying to teach him how to ride a bike. He was not doing it without training wheels, none of that. He would go over there and then go over my stepmom's house and he got it instantly. My daddy taught me and my papa said, I'm like, what is this about Robert that he can get this done, but I can't. Like, what's up? So, I mean, that's just all I wanted to say is that, you know, through it all, I did appreciate him for being the father that he was. And I know that Aiden will miss him dearly and so will I.
I'm Megan, I'm Bobby's cousin. We met him, you probably haven't seen me, but I probably have, and my cousin Keaton. And I stayed with them for a little while, a couple years ago. And I wasn't really like that close to them, but you know, when he show up and gets her home, and they really looked out for me. And, you know, Bobby was really, really, like, you know, overprotective to me. Like, you know, I was, like, 21 and, like, you know, trying to figure out my life. And he was really, like, inspiring. And he always shared, like, the most uplifting and, you know, positive messages. And I remember just being really amazed at how, again, like I said, we weren't that close, but I was there. And we were in the basement and we like smoked a joint or whatever. And like, I met all his friends and everything, and Sam was there, I think. And
he really just was like, you know, protective. I do remember like the snake and everything. I was just like really scared and like really timid, and he just made me feel very comfortable around everybody and throughout the rest of my time there. And just as of recently, last month, you know, I was, you know, trying to move on with my life, and you know, I reached out to him, and he was so willing to help me. Like, he checked in on me like nobody's ever checked in on me before. Like, he texts me like every single day, like, you know, I'm working right now, but I'll call you after this. You know, he was like helping me with my credit, and he was, you know, able to do that successfully. And I really didn't get a chance to tell him thank you, you know, like really a big thank you. But I did tell him thank you, you know, generally. But I just, you know, said that to say that I'm very proud of all the children and, you know, his siblings, because I know that they carry on that same spirit, and I know that his knowledge and his help really has inspired me and has motivated me and really, really been a big help in my life, even though, like I said, we weren't that close. And I just really admire you as a mom and everything that you've done here. You did everything, you know, and I saw that, you know, and I want to do the same thing for my son. And I just want everybody to know that, you know, no matter if you have family that you're not close to where you are, it just goes to show that people do know the true meaning of the family, and Bobby loves that, and I just want to say thank you.
Aiden's grandmother, I just wanted to say that I love Robert so much. He was like a son to me. When Aiden was born, I was so happy. He gave me the greatest joy. He was a good person, so sweet. Mom, or Pops, my husband, they were very close. He treated Robert like a son and loved him like a son. He was a good person, and I love his children, his family, and his mom.
She didn't say a whole lot, but those two right here, oh my God, this crazy one right here, y'all don't know how crazy he is, but my God.
I do.
Man, do not mess with Robert. Probably don't mess with nobody he loves, but don't mess with Robert. Do not. This man stepped up like he was his own dad and would defend him to the life. Oh my gosh, sometimes like, I don't know if I want to tell Chris, because he might act a fool, and we don't want him to act a fool. But Chris and Jan, I'm so grateful that you guys stepped in and loved my son the way that you did.
He was easy to love.
Yeah.
I appreciate it. Anybody else? I know his friends got something to say, but you at? I know your mind. This is one, I found a note today I was looking at. That I wrote to Robert when I was giving him conditions on how he can come back home. I said, and stay away from the following. Your mom, Pino, and Buggy.
Come on, though, this is so hard. But why he get himself together?
Woo! Those two right there. The way they started, they were enemies. And then they became frenemies.
So everybody did. Don't know me, my name is Jovan. Robert, like she said, was my enemy. Fourth grade year, he came to my school. In my grade, I was running things. No interruptions. He came and made a disturbance. And that was pretty much like the clash of titans. Both of us pretty much established ourselves as, hey, I'm a free thinker. I'm myself, I'm whole. I will not let nobody push me around. I will not be tested. He showed me that. His mother showed me that. chasing me around the neighborhood in the car and somehow found out where I live. I thought I was home free till I turned left and the garage door was open and I knew what time it was. I won't be coming outside for the next 3 months. But overall, throughout our history of growing up, we've seen each other change as men and see each other like things. I remember when I first met him, he was telling me about how he was a swimmer and he had medals and different things like that. Then we got older. We started experimenting. We went to a store called Spencer's. We found a book. It was a marijuana book. Teach you how to make it, put it in food, everything. And that was 12 years ago. And watching him grow, he always kept that with him. He was always himself. He was always cool and chill. He will turn up. Don't get him wrong, because he is a protector. He is about his family. Like, the first thing, if something go wrong, I can protect my family. I don't care, bro. I don't care. You don't understand. It's like, bro, yeah, it's cool. I got you. I'm riding with you. It's cool. But him growing to become a man that he was always there for his children, something that I honored about him as a person. I always told him, like, man, I'm growing proud of you, because a lot of people that we know, they move different, they think different. A lot of people not here anymore, a lot of people in jail. And through all his sacrifices and things that he went through in his life, he did something in the end that made sense, you know what I'm saying? And I loved him. Like, that was my brother, Brandon. It's my brother. These guys that's with me, they all my brothers. I know him since kid. It's like I'm the big brother out of all of them. It hurt to see it happen like this. But I know he laughing right now. He's like, ha ha ha. I finally beat y'all. I'm out of here. I told y'all I'm sick of this life, this world, because he understood how to. Exactly. He understood the matrix. He understood everything. And he taught his kids that. So to his kids, I love y'all. I'm here for y'all to the day I die. Anything and everything y'all need, I got y'all.
Hey, we talked about this a lot, you know. I always thought that he'd be the one speaking, but, you know. I had to think about when I first met Rob. And it was before we was friends. And these things used to come out, and I used to see him, like, he'd go to Isaac's house. Basically, he had a sign that said, like, excuse my language, but fuck with me. And a lot of people did, you know, but he made it through all that, even from an eighth grade teacher lying on a little kid, you know, to a lot of things. Even when we were adults, him just making a straight business deal, and a person just trying to snake him out, you know, but he made it through it. And for these past 2 years, I've seen him, you know, really turn into a man. I seen the same little boy that used to rip his hair out because he ain't have money because he had a boy on the way and he didn't have nothing to show for it. But he turned all of that around in these past 2 years, built his credit up. He didn't let nothing stop him. Sometimes, even if something was going bad in my life, I didn't even want to call him because he was focused. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to distract nobody like that. And right here, what happened is the only thing that could stop him from working for his kids, could stop him from anything, you know? So, y'all, you already know what your dad wants y'all to do. Keep everything going and remember everything he taught y'all. I hope all the guys, y'all already know everything he taught us. Got me into a whole different spirituality of knowing myself, you know, and I'm gonna keep that going. So I hope everybody, if you got some knowledge from him, keep that going, you know, not just today, every day after this, you know. When his mama needs something, pick up that phone, you know. So just celebrate the wonderful life and then see what he became, you know. He did a lot, but everything he took from this world, he tried to give back, and he cared about everybody. He loved everybody. Yeah. Sometimes even being naive sometimes comes in love. But just thank y'all for being this family. So that's all I got to say.
Anything that we receive will be put in the trust for them. And you can purchase some of his edibles. These are made with the last bit of stuff that he had left. And please eat some of the whatever's left of the food back there. Everything is vegan. He was vegan. He was like the vegan Nazi. So, you know, even when the kid, I couldn't be that grandma trying to sneak the kids some McDonald's. And he, oh my gosh, that's just the wrong thing to do. You what? You gonna get him a little bit of cigarettes or something? And, you know, don't do that. Don't do that. So I had to honor his word. He wanted them to eat vegan. I said, but they gonna go home and they ain't gonna eat vegan. I don't care. They gonna eat vegan while they're here. So I had to honor.
Y'all doing? My name is Adam. Ron was my best friend since we were shorties. I had no recollection of how we became friends. We just one day was friends. We was friends every day. Like Mr. Keishano and my mother, we put them to hell. I think the reason we stopped kicking was because we couldn't no more. Like it got that bad. We'd do dumb stuff like this, ride our bikes like 10 miles away and realize we gotta get back. And then we're going to the store and like steal paintball guns and BB guns and we're using that day, like, all right. And when we was kids, we got along because we realized that his mother was a teacher and most people in my family are teachers, so we used to kind of outthink a lot of people, but we had heart and I was kind of an outcast and so was he. But a lot of the people who we was outcast to eventually loved us, you know? But I remember one time I was in a fight in seventh grade and I was getting beat up and he ran off on a bike and he said, he found my sister. He said, Ayana had him getting his ass beat down the street. I'm thinking like, why you ain't helping me? It ain't But in that time it was like, it was a bunch of them against me and he was like in the middle. They ain't had no beef with him. I think we'll tell it right there. And it was Bino though, like really me and Bino wouldn't get along until later, but it was through Rob, like, cause we stopped kicking it on some, we did some bad stuff. I think I was in eighth grade and he was in seventh and I hadn't seen him until like my freshman year. We was over at Jovan's house and he was with Bino and he, I'm looking like, man, don't talk to me bro, but you know, if that's your homie, that's gonna always be your homie. We ain't gonna really have no hard feelings. I'm just like, the way it fell out, His eye was twitching. He said, look, bro, my eye tweaking. Okay. I'm like, bro, get down on my face. You close his head, we was sitting on your couch. And then again, like, we was just cool again. And I went off to school. I came back. He had got fat. I saw him at the Citgo. I'm like, damn, what up, bro? Like, you good? Yeah, man. That's the same Robbie's voice is deep. He said, I gotta go to jail for a unit. I'm like, what was you doing when I was gone? And then we linked up again. And we always stayed in contact. It wasn't ever like, you know, your real friends, you could not see them for a year or two. You pick up where you left off. And it's like fate just kept bringing us back together. We kept running to, we went off and made different friends, and they ended up all being friends. And we like, but it was cool, because it was like most people in this crib don't know that this my boy. Like, I remember he broke his arm doing something stupid. And then we used to go to the store and get gasoline and set the forest on fire. These are real stories. Like, we was smoking sugar. We was trying all the bad stuff. And then when we got older, we was just chilling. And he had went and lost a lot of weight. And that's when I would come over like at 1 in the morning. Like, all right, let's go to the gym. And we'd go to, yeah, I see a little man. That's us. And he made this joke. He was like, but I don't think he was joking. Y'all know Robert, because he was dead ass. He said, I'd be damned if I fall off a cliff and I just can't do one pull-up to pull myself up. And then he did like a pull-up and did a backflip on a bar. I'm like, in the gym, you do that outside. But you know that Rob was Rob. I had got a little bit more mature. He started having kids. And then even towards the end of his life, like y'all was there like at Scott House all the time. We kicked it every day again, just like when he was a kid. And when you look at all these good memories that we got in this room about him, we got to draw from that and from each other, because, you know, it ain't going to be easy getting through it. But you go to people's funerals and memorials, and they probably was a nothing person. And they try to make up stuff like this person was good, but he really was good. Like I said before, him, help everyone make peace. And he wasn't no punk about it. He wasn't trying to be peaceful because he didn't want to be, like, in no fight or nothing. He was trying to be peaceful because he was worried about what he'd do to you for somebody who he loved. And he's, I kid y'all not, since we were, what was it, third, fourth grade? He the same person. He just got better. He just kept growing. He never, like, would never let nobody say nothing about his friends in front of him. It was over. He kept these little kids with him, the boys and the girls, and we'd be like, bro, you can't really have these kids over. Like, this is the worst part. But he's like, they got to learn how to live. I trusted him too with all that, so. And he was just like, wow. Like, he was wow. Like, he always been one of the best people I knew, for sure. And that's real. I'm not just saying that because he's gone, that he always has been. Like, when I was doing a lot of stuff, he was always a friend. And that's coming from when we was little kids, he was always right there. We would ride our bikes and we had pegs on the back, and we learned how to stand on the pegs, and we never stopped doing it. So I called him, like, hey, let's go play basketball at James' house. He'd be like, bro, I was just in the car, you bro. He'd be like, that's ESP. I'm like, ESPN? But I didn't know about none of that stuff yet, so it was just funny. And when we became grown men, we always experimented with stuff, but when we became grown men, he started, like, doing psychedelics and shrooms and stuff. And he had this crazy story. I thought he was out of his mind. He was like, bro, I think I did way too many because the refrigerator had me in the chokehold. Because y'all know he was animated. He didn't do what he's talking about to explain what he's saying, so he'd get on the floor, start choking himself. But he like 22 at the time. I'm like, bro, you was hilarious, man. Niggas always made him laugh, man. I remember when he got into, like, yo, when we got into it and actually learned how to make food from scratch and everything. And it was a whole bunch of times we'll be in the kitchen and we was gonna leave. And I didn't know she liked me yet, because I was like, she had, last time we saw her, she hated me. I was just like, all right, I'm different, Mr. Keish. I'm not gonna influence your son no more, but it wasn't influence. We just had each other's backs. We both had just a bunch of bad ideas, and we always went with the worst one. But we always made it home. So, you know, you're a child too, and I can see these people here who love him, and we all got memories with him. And it's like Bino said, we gotta be here for his family. Like, we can't just be saying that because we in our feelings. Like, if she lived us 10 years from now, if we alive, we gotta pick that phone up and help these kids. These kids know who we are. Most people, like, even a guy, like, and y'all been around us, so we still y'all uncle. Like Chris, I met him at my job. It's like 6 months ago. I was training him, and we started talking. He started showing me pictures of his family, and it was, hey, man, that's my nephew. And then he was like, I'm like, no, I know Rob. Like, I've been to Rob, bro. I'm like, how you doing? He was like, he good. I'm like, he crazy still. He's like, yeah. He still Rob there, but he do what he do, you know him. This is, I don't know, man. You get lost in words sometimes, even when I'm talking about it. It's so much I could say, so much I want to say, but that dude was amazing. We was going to go out to the city because one of our friends was on house arrest, and he was like, hold on, bro. And on what? He pulled out his gun and shot the wall. I swear to God. But I was so little off, like, I would have been like, all right, well, you go for you, shoot me. I don't know what he been doing, this, but he was being himself. And he had a bunch of steam that he used to have to let off. But he was so smart. Like, you had to keep up with him in the conversation. He would think. You couldn't scare him. He was fearless. He was a daredevil like him. He lived his life to the fullest for sure. Like, he was never no laid out. Even when he'd be high, he'd never just be laid out doing nothing. He'd get up doing something that he done thought about. You have a conversation with nothing. It was well thought out. Even though he was impulsive sometimes, it was well thought out. Especially at this age that we are now. This is good, man. You know, it's really good to see y'all here. This now we know each other through him, like, and we got a common thing and interests. I mean, with each other, we love him. So, thank you.
Good evening, my brothers and sisters. I'm the Reverend Ernest Glover Sr. And I first met Robert when he was a little guy. He used to play with my sons. He used to come in the backyard and play with my son, play basketball. And he was a lot bigger than him, but he was around the same age, I think.
Grab the mic.
And the other day I was cutting some grass. That was last week, a week before. I forget when it was. I think it was a Tuesday. And I was cutting grass, and you know when you're doing something.
Temptation, but give